During the real world CTF, we had to decide which challenges to try and which not to. FlaglLab was listed as a web challenge and had the following description. You might need a 0 day. You get a link to a hosted website as well as a download link. It turns out that there was a GitLab hosted, and from the download, which contains a Docker compose file, it tells us that it's GitLab version 11.4.7. So we quickly searched for how old that version is, and we found this blog from the 21st of November about this release. Remember that we were playing on 1st of December, so we thought, oh crap, that seems like the latest up-to-date version. We won't ever find a 0 day in this huge code base, let's not waste our time. Turns out we kinda effed up. During a post-CTF dinner with other teams, some people from RPISec told me that it was not the latest release. There was a 11.4.8, and the commit history of that newer version reveals several security patches. And one of them, the SSRF in webhooks, was even by Nyangava of Chaitin Tech, which is the company that organizes the CTF. Knowing all that, it was actually a super simple challenge, and I'm so mad that I gave up on this challenge so quickly, because 5 more minutes of research would have been enough to lead me down to a path of solving this. Anyway, after the CTF, I sat down and I tried to use this knowledge now to solve the challenge. Okay, so first we have to set everything up. I noticed that in the Docker compose file some absolute paths are used, so I changed them to relative paths. These folders will be mounted onto this path inside of the Docker container. We can also see here that a flag file is required that is loaded into the root of the file system, as well as some other password file. Then we can simply type docker compose up to pull the Docker images, which during the CTF would have taken ages because of Chinese internet. Once it's all downloaded, the Docker container is starting up and GitLab starts to do its setup magic, which takes more time. But looks like it's done now. Then I start Chrome with some parameters to set a HTTP proxy. From the Docker compose file, you can also learn that the HTTP port 80 is mapped to port 5080. So let's try to open that page in Chrome. But I haven't started the proxy yet, so let me start burp and here we go. By the way, I wasn't able to intercept requests to 127.0.0.1 at first, and I'm not sure exactly why. I checked the excluded ranges, but that wasn't it. However, I found out by specifying a fake domain in etc host for localhost, so localhost.com, Chrome will do the request over the proxy, and we can see here the requests in the history. Okay, now that we are set up, we have to find the bug to exploit. Like I said in the beginning, we thought it was an up-to-date version, but in fact there was a newer version, 11.4.8, with several security issues fixed. And one even referenced Chaitin Tech, who organized the CTF. We also know that the flag is in the root of the file system, so we need a file disclosure vulnerability or a remote code execution. So let's have a look at the patches. To do that, we can simply go to the official GitLab repository and search for the tag with the 11.4.8 version. Next, we can look at the commit history to look for the security patches, and we can immediately find these merge commits of security patches. A SSRF issue with IPv6 in webhooks, IXSS, which is rather uninteresting, and a CRLF issue, carriage return line feed, so a new line injection. Now we can have a quick look at them. Here's the SSRF issue with IPv6, fix SSRF and project integrations. The cool thing about well-documented and structured software projects is that developers write tests. So we can just scroll down to the test that will make sure no regressions of this bug reappears. These tests basically tell us how it was possible to exploit this issue. So apparently IPv6 URLs like 0000FFFF127.001 bypasses the block URL check. This is a special IPv6 address to embed an IPv4 address. Cool. The other issue was fix CRLF vulnerability in project hooks. And also scrolling down some tests, we see it was simply about URLs with new lines, either URL encoded as %A or simply regular new lines. So now the question is, Do these issues make sense and help us in any way to exploit GitLab? Yes, this can be turned into a remote code execution. It's actually a very typical security issue. It's a SSRF, a server-side request forgery, which you can use to target the local internal Redis database, which is used extensively and very typically for different types of workers. And so you can push a malicious worker package and that leads to an arbitrary code execution. And GitLab was exploited like this several times before. It's a known CTF challenge. And there are many bug bounty write-ups about this topic. It's difficult for me to remember where I saw this technique the first time, but I believe it was Agari, Nicolas Gregoire, in like 2014 or 2015, but I definitely also read several bug bounty write-ups over the years about it. So every web pen tester and web bug bounty hunter should actually know this. But let's first check if we can trigger a SSRF somewhere. At first I thought about targeting webhooks, which can be used to specify a URL that GitLab will send a request to when things happen on the repository, but specify a localhost URL instead. But when I clicked on create new project, I noticed the import project option. And here are multiple ways to import a repository, one being from a Git repository URL. And here are a few examples. We can use a HTTP, HTTPS, or Git URL to enter a repository. And so for example, we could try to enter localhost here instead, so 127001, and try to import from there. But we get an error that import URL is blocked. Requests to localhost are not allowed. But we can try the IPv6 bypass, which we have found in the patch. I already went ahead into burp and put the request to import this URL into the repeater and replaced the URL with the IPv6 version. I also added port 1234 here, for a reason you see in a second. To test this SSRF, we need to get into the GitLab Docker container. So docker ps to find the running container, and then we can do docker exec with -it to keep std in and create a sudo tty terminal. Specify the container ID and execute bin bash to get a shell. This process is now running inside of the container, so we have a shell here. Netcat is not installed, so we first have to apt update and then apt install netcat. Once this is done, we can simply netcat and listen on port 1234. Next, we go into burp repeater. We have to adjust the name of the project because we created it already, and so for a new project, we need a new unique name. And when we send the request to import this repository, after a short moment, we receive an HTTP GET request to the URL that we have specified. Awesome. SSRF to localhost confirmed. Now we want to target Redis with this. Redis is an open source in-memory data structure store used as a database, cache, and message broker. And it works basically with key and value pairs. And the protocol it uses to communicate is absolutely simple. It's a line-based command protocol. With ps, we can find the Redis server command and the port 6379. And then we can use netcat to connect to it. And as you can see, we can enter any invalid commands and Redis will simply inform us from it being wrong. Even when you enter a valid but incomplete commands, it just responds with an error. Let's try a valid command. Let's set the key LiveOverflow to test. That went okay. And set more garbage. And now we get the value of LiveOverflow. And here it is, test. As you know, netcat simply opens a TCP socket and we are sending here simple ASCII payloads to Redis. HTTP is also a simple ASCII text-based protocol. And some really smart people realized, well then, what would happen if you simply sent an HTTP GET request to Redis? Each line of the HTTP GET request would then be a Redis command, no? To test this, we can simply copy the GET request from the SSRF and paste it into netcat session with Redis. And we see an error, wrong number of arguments for GET command, which makes sense because GET is a Redis command. But then we also somehow drop back to the shell. Let's connect again and do it line by line. GET, and we see the error, and next the host HTTP header, host colon, boom, connection dropped. Because SSRF to Redis is such a huge issue, Redis has actually introduced a fix where they basically try to detect an arriving HTTP request. This callback is bound to post and host colon command names. Those are not really commands, but are used in security attacks in order to talk to Redis instances via HTTP with a technique called cross-protocol scripting, which exploits the fact that services like Redis will discard invalid HTTP headers and will process what follows. As a protection against this attack, Redis will terminate the connection when a post or host colon header is seen and will log the event from time to time. So you should maybe check your Redis logs for this warning. If you see it, you have some big issues. So that's why this connection is dropped here at the host colon. But this is a GET request, and GET is actually a valid Redis command. So if we can somehow get Redis commands in front of host, then we could still execute some. And this is where new line injection could help us. Commands have to be at the start of the line. So the idea would be to simply use new lines in the GET path. And if that works, we could inject commands before the host header. But when I tried that with a few lines to test it, I noticed that no request arrives. I don't have the time to dig into the code why. Maybe this particular request was already protected against this. I don't know. Damn. But I had another idea. The supported protocols are HTTP, HTTPS, and Git. I actually have never looked into how the Git protocol looks like and what it sends when you try to Git clone this repository, so I simply used netkit again and performed a Git clone with a Git URL to localhost and that port. And this is what we get. Netkit receives some weird data. Git upload pack and that URL path. Test protocol Git. So we can control this part, and maybe new line injection works here. Let's try it. I go to burp again, change the protocol from HTTP to Git, and check if netkit will receive it. One moment please. There we go. We receive it, and the new lines are there. Awesome. Now we just have to figure out what we can send to Redis to get code execution. Luckily, like I said, GitLab had this issue multiple times before, so we can find an awesome write-up by Jobert where he shared this technique of using the GitLab queue for system hooks and registers a GitLab shell worker which eventually will execute this command here, in this case who am I, and sends it via netkit away. Cool. So I first quickly check if we can reach my outside laptop from within Docker, and so I look up my IP and set up a netkit listener. And then from inside the Docker container, I try to connect there, and yes, that works. So now we just have to copy those Redis commands. I noticed that each command has to have some spaces in front because for whatever reason, they get swallowed by something. And I also added a few execs because otherwise the last command would be invalid because of how the SSRF sends it. And of course, the very important, we replace the payload with cut/flag and send the output away to my laptop with netkit. Now we just have to execute it, wait a moment, and boom, the flag arrives. Damn, this was so simple. After having heard from the guys at RPISec that 11.4.7 was not the latest version and there were security issues reported by Chai Tin about SSRF, it was just a matter of maybe 2 or 3 hours. I had to fight with some setup issues and stuff never goes smooth. But it was all straightforward regardless. If we had just looked at this during the CTF, why did you write 0 day when in fact it was a 1 day? We were so scared because of that reason. It makes me so mad, dang it. Anyway, glad I solved it after all.